speakers. Our second later speaker is Viktoria Driker. Is that, am I pronouncing it right? Viktoria Driker. She is a senior software engineer at Actian. But first, our next speaker is going to be the director of support for Actian, who's got 20 years of industry experience, originally starting at Computer Associates way back in 1996. And has formerly been on the Ingress team before it became Actian. Please welcome Nick Makos.
Who came here just for the camera and the Echo Dot? You get one of these. All right. Here's our agenda. I'll try and be brief. I'm going to introduce you to Actian Corporation, who we are. We're going to talk a little bit about big data and data visualizations, why we visualize our data, what's the problem that today's enterprise face when they query big data in the enterprise, what our solution is, and then finally, Viktoria is going to give you a few demos. I'll be back there. So we're an Actian Corporation, where our name is new. We've been around for quite a long time. Like Ed said, one of our original databases is Ingress. It's been around for 30 plus years is one of the original databases along with Oracle and IBM. We're headquartered in Redwood City, California. We spun out of Computer Associates. And we have offices all over the world, Australia, India, the UK, Germany, Paris, and a lot of offices here in the United States. We're an end-to-end analytics company. Through many acquisitions, we developed or we acquired tools that let you load your data into your database. We have NoSQL databases, transactional databases, and of course the vector database that we're going to speak about today. You see a lot of big names here on the screen. Anybody knows why FedEx uses Ingress for? It's really simple. Anyone?
Track packages.
There you go. Track packages. Lufthansa actually is pretty mission critical. They use, again, the Ingress database for flight planning of how many vegetarian meals you need, how much fuel each aircraft should have, and, you know, the era of 9/11 or some other airport shutting down situations, you need to know how much fuel your aircraft has and where you can divert it safely. So all that runs on Ingress. Disney uses our Zen database for ticket issuing and for fast passes. So if you're ever in line in Disney and there's a long line in front of you, give me a call, I might be able to do something. I don't have access to it. eBay uses Actian Vector for price matching. So imagine how many millions of people a day trying to list listings on eBay. So they use Actian Vector to look in the marketplace and give you a price recommendation. Xerox also uses Actian Vector for, you know, their printers and faxes, how much if your ink is low, they'll tell you right away. So, who can tell me what big data is?
Anything bigger than it's easy for you to process.
There you go.
Exactly.
Okay, another one flying.
We don't have insurance for that. So big data is exactly that. It's a collection of data sets that are large and complex in nature. So they're defined by those three Vs, volume, velocity, and variety. We have the fourth V with us, Viktoria, for the demos later on. So volume is really the scale of data. It can range anywhere from terabytes to zettabytes. Velocity is the rate at which the data comes in. In the old days, it used to be just batch jobs. Somebody, 8 o'clock at night, started a batch job, came in the morning, it was done, he was happy. But now we have real-time data, streaming data, and your solution better be able to keep up with the data as it comes in, because if you can't process it at the same rate or faster, then you're going to end up with a queue and you'll never be able to catch up. And then the variety, it comes, you know, data comes from different sources. It's either structured data or unstructured data. You can tell me what structured data is. Anyone? Yeah, you can see that in a relation table. You have your employees table, first name, last name, social security, that's structured data.
everything.
And everything else pretty much on structured data, whether it's machine logs, whether it's video, audio, etc. So in today's day and age, there's, you know, the velocity, the volume, and the variety of data is overwhelming. Facebook, for example, has 300 million photographs posted every day. Walmart has 1 million transactions every day. A 1 hour car ride can generate about 25 gigs of data. That's one car in 1 hour. I'm guessing it's a Tesla. So imagine you multiply that by the hundreds of millions or the billions of cars on the planet, and you understand right away how much data it can ingest. So you want to be able to act on this data. We have the Internet of Things. We have wind turbines, water meters, etc., that produce thousands of data points every hour. So enterprises want to act on this data, they want to collect the data, and of course they want to report really fast on this data. Here's a real life scenario that happened to me. I was away and I got an email that from DEP that I had a leak. It was last year, of course. It says from April 2nd to April 7th, we used water at a higher rate. So they looked at my water meter, they were on their batch job or their weekly report, and they saw that it was much higher. So that was great to save me some money, but imagine they told me that hour for the same day was saving me a couple $100. So they aggregated the data, they saw that my water use was much higher than normal, and they sent me an email, and lo and behold, I made a phone call and it was fixed. So who can tell me why we want to visualize our data?
Yes.
Exactly. So we visualize our data for what we call the power of the reveal. We can discover patterns, we can take action on data, it really tells a story. For example, if I gave you, this is Google's closing stock price for the past year, and if I gave you this Excel spreadsheet, it's the third column actually, you'd be able to, look at a couple of cells, tell me, oh, it was lower one day, higher the other day, but you wouldn't be able to tell a story, you wouldn't be able to know that if I actually visualize the data, you know, it was $850 about a year ago, and that's about $1,050, it had a high of, you know, almost $1,200. So it actually, you know, it tells a story. It makes sense out of the data. So here's another one. This is the bicycle incidents that are reported to the New York City Police Department. This is a few years old. So every data point is, I guess, somebody fell with a bicycle, hurt themselves, and reported to the police. But this data doesn't really tell a story because it's just too convoluted. So if I use a heat map, then I can tell that, for example, in the Lower East Side, there's many more accidents as opposed to the Lower West Side. So one can, you know, attribute this to the fact that people in Brooklyn get a bicycle, they cross a bridge, and they get into some type of accident, as opposed to somebody from Jersey going through the Holland Tunnel with their bicycle. I'm sure it would be fun. But nobody does it, hence the less amount of accidents on the west side. So now we have, you know, we have our data, we know we want to visualize our data. So we say, okay, let's go buy a BI tool, and, you know, gonna report our data and every life's gonna be all great. Who here has used any BI tools?
Tableau.
Tableau, great. We work with everything, by the way. But a lot of times, according to Gartner, about 80%, 70 to 80% of the BI projects fail and they don't deliver. There's a lot of reasons why this happens, and one of them is that the query performance is too slow. So people have traditional RDBMSs, whether it's Oracle, MySQL, Postgres, etc., but they cannot handle big data. If I was to, you know, Walmart has 2.2 million employees in their employee table. If I wanted to find out the average salary of every employee, in a relation database, I would have to bring every single row of that table, which could have first name, last name, social security, age, telephone number, depending how they normalize the data, only to extract the, you know, the salary field and then apply an average. So 2.2 million rows, if we were to do that, it will take quite some time on a traditional RDBMS. So then people said, all right, traditional RDBMS can handle this, let's try and fit everything in memory. And that will work great because you don't have to go to disk, which is the slowest component, and everything is memory. But once you hit, you know, the terabytes that we're talking about, here's a question: how many Facebook messages are posted every day? Messages.
It's in the billions.
Lower.
10 below.
Like, yeah, 4.3 billion messages a day. 4.3 billion messages a day. So imagine you have, there's no way you can fit all that in memory. So processing things on a single machine will take a lot of time. And of course, scaling is expensive. I don't know if anybody here has used Redshift or, you know, Snowflake, etc. If you were to spawn another machine, they charge you more money. So what's the result? Dashboards are slow to load, they don't come back at all, and insights are missed. So now, if you go to every BI vendor, if you go to the website, you'll have little tips and tricks on how to make your database perform. Because if your database doesn't perform, their tool doesn't perform, and you're going to throw it out. Some of the things they mentioned are, you know, hard to implement, and some of them are just ridiculous. So for example, they tell you to improve the data model. So what does that mean? And they tell you, well, if you want to get the employee and the salary, just create a new table that has only these two columns, so you don't have to fetch all the other data. So you have to sit there and manipulate your data. They tell you to optimize your tables, of course, and every BI tool has the cache of data. So when you select something from the database, they cache it either on the client or the server, so they can act fast upon it. They also tell you to restrict the usage. If your CEO runs a report at 9 a.m., they tell you don't use our new BI tool from 9 to 10 because we want the report to come back fast. They always tell you to add filters. Please don't run any query, they disallow it, because you always have to have a filter in here, otherwise you can do a full table scan and you're going to kill the BI tool and performance for everybody else. And of course, they tell you to put less visuals in your dashboard. So instead of putting two or three visuals that behind the themes they generate, you know, two or three quarters each to tell you to put, you know, one, two, three, or four, etc. Here's an actual text admitting to the shortcomings of their implementation. This is the Bureau of Transportation, a government website. And if you go on their website, let me tell you first, every airline in the United States, at the end of each month, they submit a flat file or a CSV file to the government, which has all their flights, how long they took to depart, how long it's been on the runway, when did they actually take off, how long were they on the air, if the flight was canceled, etc. This is about an $188 million data set right now. They have data from 1987 until today, and all the major airlines are in there, whether it's American Airlines, United, etc. So they actually tell you up there, note, due to the large amount of data to be searched, time periods should be limited to 1 year. So if I wanted to find out how many flights United Airlines had from 1985 until today, I would have to sit there, change it to 1 year, 95 to 96, 96, 97, which is really ridiculous. Nobody would, you know, buy that. Further down, Victoria is going to show us some demos. One is a cell phone carrier churn demo. The airline demo, which is the data that we just discussed, and an actual New York City real world example. This is all the taxi rides from 2013. There's about 1.3 billion rides. How many miles were, you know, traveled? How many passengers? Tip amounts, etc. So it's really cool. So what's our solution? If you have big data and, you know, you want to visualize it, and you're stuck with, you know, a traditional relational database, what do you do? The answer is, our solution is you use Active Vector, which, as you saw, is the world's fastest database. There's a benchmark called TBCH. It's an industry standard benchmark. We published our benchmark in June 2016 with 2.2 million queries per hour. That's what this means. If you notice, you'll see everything before that is SQL Server. They actually core our Vector technology. Vector was born out of a research paper from the University of Amsterdam, which is where, you know, Vector was first conceived. And then eventually a lot of people started applying vectorization, but we're going to see later on why this doesn't work. You don't see Oracle or Sybase up there. The last Sybase IQ was posted in 2013, Oracle 11G, and, you know, also 2013. other vendors like HP use our software to publish benchmarks. They use their own, you know, HP has had Vertica, which is another analytical database. So this is a slide that has builds. My apologies, but I wanted to cover all three sources of externally validated performance. So first is what we saw is the TPCH benchmark. So the next one is a Sigma paper that we presented. This is a conference that database professionals attend and they do peer review. You cannot see the numbers here, but you know we're 600 times faster than Hive. A little bit of gap here, that's a logarithmic scale. And we're here, you can see it in this, how much time everybody, how much slower everybody else is. If I didn't mention, Actian Vector runs on Windows and Linux on a single box. You can also run it on Hadoop if you have multiple nodes. And we also run on AWS and Azure. Yeah. Yes?
So you mentioned Vector.
Okay.
And then you mentioned Vector H.
Yes, Vector H is an adorable vector with Hadoop implementation. In the end, I have as many questions. And then finally, we have partner validation. One of our partners is Inside Software. They use they have a product called Hubble. It's an ERP, BI tool. That it does pretty much everything. Again, small fonts, but here is us. You can't really see. And then everybody else is how much lower they are. And a lot of big players are in there. Snowflake, Amazon Redshift, etc. So when people first experience Vector, they kind of remind me of this scene. This is the movie The Founder. I don't know if anybody's seen it, it's a great movie. This is Ray Kroc, who eventually is gonna go ahead and lead McDonald's. This is in the 50s and 60s. And this is his first experience with fast food.
McDonald's, may I take your order?
Yeah, give me a hamburger, a french fries, and a Coca-Cola.
That'd be 35 cents, please.
Great.
15 cents is your change. Here you are.
What's this?
Your food.
No. I just ordered.
And now it's here.
You sure? All right. Where the, you know, silverware and the plates and everything.
You just eat it straight out of the wrapper and then throw it all out.
All right.
So we did this a couple of times and we had people come up to us and say, how is that possible? How is Vector so fast? And, you know, their expectations of performance were shattered just like his expectations were shattered. You know, first time ever, so fast food, he thought it would take as long as if he sits down in a diner. 10-20 minutes, but it came back in seconds. So this is the same results we get when people experience Vector for the first time. In front of you, you will see a couple of brochures. We have more here, or you can go on our website, www.actium.com. These are performance reports that Mike Nash Consulting did for us. They took Vector and they pit it against the SQL Server, Redshift, Cloudera, Impala, and Snowflake. And you can see the numbers, how much faster we are. I can go into more detail about what the benchmark does, but it's pretty much, they scale it up to 10 terabytes of data, and they run the tests. So you can see how much faster we are. So this is Vector. The nickname or the name originally when they conceived it was X100. Does everybody know what that means? Why was it codenamed X100? Yes, because they wanted to be 100 times faster than anything that was out there. And they did that, as you can see. So please lock the doors, because these are the secrets of Vector, and I can't let you out after I tell you. So what we do is, number one, vectorized processing. So what is a vector? You can think of vector as an array of, you know, of data. It's usually 1,024 at a time. So what vectorized processing does is you can operate on the data at the same time. You don't have to go one at a time, but 1,024 at a time. So with one instruction, you operate on multiple data. So this is one reason. Now, I told you that Microsoft borrowed vectorization. There's a lot of compilers, and you know, they're gonna attempt vectorization, but it's not something, it's just built on. It has to be built from the, you know, bottom up, which is what we did with X100, and which is why we achieve our performance results. The second one is chip cache. With the, you know, disk is getting faster, RAM is getting faster, although today that doesn't mean that you can access the RAM faster. But nothing is faster or has processed faster as the on-chip cache. So what we do is we operate on the chip cache. We do not operate in memory, we just wait to load the vectors into the level 2 or level 3 cache, and then we process the data in the chip. So that's the second. Third one is we're a second generation columnar. What does that mean? We're a columnar database. So if you want to do the average of salary, you don't have to bring in all the other, you know, fields of the database. But what we also have is what we call PDT, positional delta trees. It's something we patented, and it allows you to actually update columns, delete, and insert in Hadoop at the same time that you do queries, and your query speed does not get affected. For that reason, we're a second generation columnar database. The other thing is we use smart compression. We don't compress for, you know, maximum compression. We just use our algorithms to maximize throughput. You usually get anywhere from 3 to 6 compression ratio. So if you add, I don't know, 10 terabytes worth of data, if you put it in a vector database, you'll be about 3 to 4 terabytes, depending. You don't have to pick the compression, but we pick it for you. It's all automatic. You just create the table, load the data, and we apply compression on disk. Number five, a lot of databases tell you to create secondary indices, look at your word clauses, and create indices. We tell you to avoid that. We do not like indices. Why? Because we create them automatically. What we do, we call them min-max. So think of a block on disk, it's about 112 meg. We have, this, for example, the age. We have a minimum and maximum value. So we say the minimum maximum value of, and this block is 30 to 40 years old, for example. So somebody does a query that says select star from employees where age is less than 25, we know automatically to discard that, don't fetch it from disk. We also have a patented buffer pool manager, and we know what data might be used next and what data we need to evict from memory. And finally, really important is the multi-core parallelism. What this does is we can scale in any number of cores and CPUs. We tested up to 130, I think. And what this allows you is you can have also a lot of concurrency. A lot of systems out there, whether it's Redshift or Snowflake, they tell you you can have up to maximum to 8 or 20 users. We have vector being used by hundreds or thousands of users and connections at a time. So these are the six secrets that make us really fast. So, yes.
So you're saying that the number five is a patent?
The stored indices are not. It just stores the minimum and the maximum value. But the buffer pool, what to evict, what to bring next, it's patented. So what does this mean? After the 2008 crisis in the US and Europe, they wanted to make sure that banks did not expose themselves to risk. So this is for a major UK banking institution. At the end of a trading day, they had 2 billion risk data points created. So they wanted to load all the 6 billion, the 2 billion data points in about 6 hours so they can report on them. So at the end of every trading day, it was 4 o'clock, they want to load all the data by 10 o'clock at night. And they wanted to do that in 6 hours. A full deaggregation, it's the tolerance of somebody sitting in front of his PC and running a BI report, and they wanted to run in 30 seconds. If you applied a filter, they wanted to run in less than 15 seconds. And then they told us, hey, we also want to store historical data. So how about we store 80 days, which is 160 billion rows of data. They also told us we might want to expand to the Asian markets, China, so we might need to create 10 billion data rows per day as opposed to 2 billion that they create right now. And finally, they want to be able to drill up and down. So what we did is we put this in vector. So the actual time it took to load the 2 billion data points was 1 hour and 40 minutes. The full deaggregation took 6 seconds in a 5-node cluster, and we saw better than linear improvement when we added more nodes. So in a 10-node cluster, it took 2 seconds to run the full deaggregation. Filter aggregation with sub-second response time, we're able to store all the way up to 100 days, 200 billion rows with linear scaling, of course. Same thing with the horizontal scalability. And then the drill up and down, it took less than 1 second. The tool to measure this can only measure in seconds, so something like half a second. So to summarize, what is Actian Vector? You know, it's enterprise class SQL, BI and analytics that runs in a single box in Hadoop on your AWS or Azure. It's fully ANSI 2003 compliant, so that means you can just pick your favorite tool, plug it in, and it will work with Vector. Well, fully ACID compliant. Some Hadoop vendors support eventual consistency, but like I say, when I transfer money from my savings to my checking, I don't want the data to eventually get there. I want it to get there right away. So we support that. The update capability, we're able to do that through a patented positional delta tree that I told you. We can do inserts, updates, and deletes in Hadoop, which is unheard of. Through our 30-year history, we know about security. We know that, you know, your job is on the line if something happens. You get emails every day about data breaches, etc. So we fully support, you know, role-based security, data protection, and encryption. We're highly performant and allow, again, high concurrency, like we discussed before. Our planner is also very mature, so when you run queries, you don't have to provide hints. You don't have to say, should I put this table first, that table next, so your joins will be as fast as, you know, you saw. We also support Yarn. I wouldn't touch anything that doesn't support Yarn. We embrace open standards. We work on the cloud. We're Hadoop distribution agnostic. And we also open our vector format for others to query. And we also support, you know, loading data from external tables, whether it's Parquet, et cetera. You can do that. You can load data into Vector. So Vector unleashes the modern hardware, so do the work so you don't have to. I don't know if you saw, if you remember the data before that I told you about the airline data, the 180 million rows. I can load it from my laptop and it will perform in seconds faster than, you know, the racks of machines. So with Vector, you don't have to create any indices. You don't have to create materialized views. No cubes, no, you know, duplicating data. You don't have to provide hints, no special SQL. You don't have to choose the compression, and you don't need expensive hardware. Like I said, if you have up to, you know, 5 or 10 terabyte, a single box can do it, and you'll get performance in seconds.
Can you
repeat that? In a single box, you can do up to 5 to 10 terabytes. Single box, as it. And like we said, we embrace open standards, so we're JDBC and ODBC compliant. On the left side, you see all your favorite data integration tools that we support directly. They have a connector for us, or JDBC or ODBC. And the right side are all your BI tools, whether it's Click, Tableau, Microsoft, etc. It's demo time. At the end, I'm gonna, if you have any questions, you can wait till the end. I just wanted to show you this. This is the govern website, as you can see here. So say I want to select, I don't know, the one with the most rows, the Southwest Airlines. So I want to see how many flights Southwest Airlines had from 2003 until today. I hit submit on their tab. Now we'll go back to the vector tab. I reverse engineer their queries and I'm able to run this. So if you pick Southwest Airlines from 2003 until 2018 and hit submit, this is the power of vector. You analyze, I don't know, 180 million rows, like I said, and it took 3.7 seconds to generate this page to get the data back. I could do the whole from 1987 until today, it's so great. Again, this is the one that has the most rows in here. Well, you see, they're still running to get the 2003 data. We came back in 2.8 seconds with, you know, 26 million flights that were departure was 9 minutes, et cetera, how long it took to taxi out, how long it took to take off, the arrival delay, et cetera. Alaska Airlines is pretty cool. I was told with Alaska Airlines, but they're usually very, very good. That's running. Notice their time is still running. It was still running for a while. But imagine, you know, in the day of Google, if you did a Google search, it took 30 minutes to come back, or 2 minutes in the way we use it. But I finally came back, so 7 to 8 flights. So that's it. This is the, you know, the airline demo. What great performance you get by using Driker. So I'll pass it on right to Viktoria, who's going to show us some cool code.
Hi everyone, my name is Viktoria Driker. I work for Actian Corporation for about 60 years now. I also started computer associates with NEC. And now I'm a senior software engineer at Actian. So I have some demos to show you guys. So I'm going to bring up my virtual box. So the first one is kind of small, right? So this one we actually ship with the product so that somebody can kind of load it and get started quickly and just kind of look at what visualization looks like. So this one has about 1 million rows, right? Not very big. It's 15.8 megabytes raw data. So when you load it, it gets compressed. It's about 3.5 megabytes when it's loaded. And it basically contains a subset of data from charm customers for self-help companies, right? To give you an idea of, like, wants to possibly leave the cell phone company, maybe they could do something to analyze the data, figure out what they can do in a particular demographic where there might be a problem with customers leaving. So this is using Tableau to visualize data. So you guys know Tableau, right? It's quite a few people that you know. So now let's look at the actual. So this is Tableau, right? This is what it looks like. You can see there's 4 visualizations. Visualization lines from direct queries against the database, and then you can actually zoom in on some particular area and take a look at what's going on in the particular area. So for example, if I went to this area, I can see by the size of the circle that, you know, there's a lot of people that are churning, right? And I can also look down here and see that the gender of the people that are churning are mostly females, right? And okay. And their education level is 5 years or above, right? So maybe we can offer these people, I don't know, free data or something, or unlimited data plans or something to prevent them from churning. So that is the point, that the power of analysis when you're analyzing data is basically, you know, bring some kind of, help you, give you insight in your business decisions. So the next demo that I wanted to show you is, airline demo that Nick was talking about. And now, this is actually, we're actually running it local on a server in-house. And this is a larger data set, as you can see. Raw data is 180 gigabytes, and it's about 18 gigabytes when you load it into Vector, right? So it gets compressed. And it provides information such as year, carriers, airports, right, delays, late departures, late arrivals, and also airports with the most or least amount of airlines, and etc. Visualizations are also in Tableau. You can see from the picture there's about 7 different graphs that are displayed, and there's a year filter on it. So you can see right now I have a 2016 filter set. So as I change the filter, you can see this is running direct queries against database, and you saw that instantly the graph pretty much refreshed, and it brought different data to the screen. So here you obviously can see different airlines that that are carriers that are supported. You know, some airlines obviously don't have a lot of flights, so they may have smaller circles. The bigger circles represent the most flights that the airline has. And then these are server airports. So basically, here, the server airport, Atlanta, Georgia, let's say, has the most flights that are coming in, right? And then on the next graph, you can see they have the most flights going out, right? So for example, how would you be able to use this data, right? So maybe as a passenger, you want to know which airlines are actually present in the airport. It might be all the way at the bottom of this chart, right? It has only two airlines that are serving it. So you want to try to get a direct flight so you can look at the airport that has the most airlines. And kind of, let's say you live in Atlanta, Georgia, you could try to pick the airline that would have possibly direct flights to the small airport, let's say in Arkansas or something that only has two flights. Some of the other information that you can have is you can see there's delay in minutes and arrival delays and departure delays. So a lot of airports get fined when they have delayed flights. So they may, for example, the airlines may want to redirect the flights to avoid certain airports to make sure that they don't get fined. So they could look at this chart and see what the average amount of minutes that flights get delayed at that airport. Okay, and from the passenger standpoint, right, if you have to, you all live in New York, right, LaGuardia Airport has a reputation, doesn't it? Right. So everybody tries to avoid LaGuardia, right, but if you actually look at this chart, and that was the interesting part for me, if you actually look at this chart and you scroll down and you try to find LaGuardia on this list, they're actually not quite that bad. I think it was like 15 or 20 minutes, I'm not seeing that right now.
Well, this is a ride.
Huh?
We don't have arrivals. We only have two tracks.
Well, there's arrival and departure. So believe it or not, there's not much difference, right? So there was maybe a difference of like 2 minutes between LaGuardia and JFK, right? So in delays. So it really doesn't make much difference whether you take flights from LaGuardia or JFK. But basically, from this as a passenger, you can tell which airports to avoid. So that's the point. Okay, so the next demo, I kind of wanted to get in a little more detail here, okay? Because this one is the big demo that we have. And I kind of wanted to really look at the queries that it's running, right? The direct queries under the covers. So the data set here is 1.3 billion rows, right? And this is a taxi and limousine commission demo. So what this is how many of you guys take taxis in New York ever in your life? Everybody, right? At some point in your life. Okay, how many people took taxi here today? All right, so you may actually end up in this database, right? So all the information for the taxi ride is recorded in this database. And we contain, this data set that we have contains information from 2009 to 2017, about 6 months into 2017. Okay, so the raw data is about 229 gig, and it's about 78 gig loaded into the vector. So it's a larger data set. And it contains all the information about the rides, such as pickups, drop-offs, passenger counts, fare tips, fare amount, tip amount, you know, total amount paid, like geographical location, like longitude, latitude, the pickup, same thing for the drop-off location, and et cetera, right? So a whole bunch of information about how they paid cash, credit card, and et cetera. So we actually used Click for the visualization. And the reason why we are showing you all these different visualizations, we want to stress the fact that you can pretty much plug in any visualization tool of your choice on top of the database and it will just work. It'll provide the visualization you're looking for. So there's several sheets on this, several visualizations that we provided, right? So. So this is the first one. So when Click initially gave us the data, they had only 2013 data of, you know, basically made up, the actual visualization were made up of 1 year of data. So we were like, okay, we went with it, right? So this contains 173 million rides, right, just for 2013 year. And it has about 1.4 billion total distance traveled by cabs, right, so calculate the total. And it was about 296 million passengers in 2013, okay? So the cool thing about Click is it has all these different tabs, right? And so you can separate your data and basically create visualizations based on the data that you are interested in. So for example, my first, this is running direct queries against the database, right? So when I just clicked the button, it went into a database and it fetched all this information. You saw it displayed fairly quickly, right? And keep in mind, the queries are coming back in basically some seconds. And don't forget that this tool also needs to take the information, render it, right, and produce it so you could actually see the graphs, right? So that takes a little bit of time. So here on the bottom, right, this is a passenger count by month, by day. So you can actually look at this data and analyze. Why would this be useful, right? So let's look at it, right? Let's analyze it. I found this data very interesting, actually. So I started looking around, and I'm like, okay, well, everybody will look at the high counts of the passengers, right? But let's say I'm a cab driver, and I want to know if I should go out and work on a holiday, right? Is it worth it? Is it not? How many passengers will they get? I mean, you think on New Year's or Christmas, a lot of people will take cabs, right? They're in a rush to get where they're going, so maybe they would take cabs, right? So let's look at the data. So I'm looking at my data, right? This is May, month's May, and the day is 27. I don't know if you can see very clearly, okay? So I went to the 2013 calendar, and I was like, what happened on 27th of May? Why is there a low point, right? It turns out that's the Memorial Day weekend, right? So on Memorial Day, apparently, nobody takes the, or less people take cabs, right? So, okay, so let's look at some of the other holidays, right? So the next one you see is 4th of July, right? So 4th of July in 2013 fell on a Thursday. And you can see the whole weekend, right? People go away for 4th of July, right? So there is very few cab rides, surprising. So the next interesting point to me was August. What happens in August? How many people know what happens in August?
Nothing?
Really? Why? Everybody has kids, right? August is a month before school, so everybody starts feverishly taking vacation, trying to spend time with their kids before they go back to school, right? That's my guesses. When I looked at this data, I was like, okay, look at this. Every weekend, there's a low usage, low passengers, right? So let's scroll all the way to the end of the year, right? And this is December. You guys can see December 25th. What's on December 25th? Right? Okay, so now I want to zoom in on my data. You can see there's some other usages. So this top graph shows you by hour, right? So what happens with cab rides by hour? This is the number of revenue you earn by hour, right? So if I wanted to, let's say, go out on December 25th, right? Let's say I don't really want to celebrate Christmas this year, right? So I wanted to go out and drive a cab. I want to know when can I earn the most amount of money, right? So I could look at my graph and I can decide, okay, after like 8 o'clock, it kind of starts to go up, right? And the peak is somewhere around midnight, 11, you know? So I would adjust my driving hours accordingly. So now the beautiful thing about Click is that I just clicked the months of December, right? And it reloaded the months of December, and now it's showing me the data, the revenue by hour for the whole month of December, so I can see what's going on with average amounts, right? So now I can zoom in even further, so I can choose my December 25th exactly, right? Which apparently fell on a Thursday, I guess, the fourth day, and then it shows you basically the amount of revenue that you could make for that one day. And you guys saw all those queries that I was clicking were direct queries that were running against the database and just fetching the information, right? And obviously, if you have a visualization tool that's a little on the slower side, the database underneath that is a little on the slower side, if you look here, you can see there's at least three queries that are running at the same time, right, to visualize each graph. And all of them go out, and each of them will scan the whole table, right, and to get the set of data. That's how these visualization tools work, right? And then it will render this data. Now, another cool thing here is if you look on top now, where my cursor is, it says pickup months and pickup day of months, right? What that means is I just clicked on buttons, remember, to zoom in on the data. Now it added filters. So now if I go to my next visualization, my filters apply to the entire visualization. So everything that I will see is now filtered by pickup months and day of months, okay? Pickup months of the day. So I can just clear my filters if I want to continue and see the data for everything. It will reload my charts. So So for the next one, let's go look at the revenue, right? So this kind of shows you, you saw there was five visualizations that ran. This just showed you some raw data here, right? Then you can see some passenger counts by month, right, for 2013. On top, you see there's a total amount of tips that was made for in 2013, total fare that was paid, so it was $2.5 billion, right? You can see number of total passengers and total distance driven, okay? And then also what type of payment they used and also the hourly passenger count. So if you wanted to see what the most passengers, it's a heat map, so it shows you the most passengers was at 7 o'clock in the evening. Okay, finally, let's go to our next tab. So this will actually load information about tips, right? So I'm trying to figure out how generous New Yorkers are. So here you can see the percentage of tip from the fare by hour. So you can see that at 8 a.m., apparently New Yorkers are the most generous because they're rushing to work, right? They're just trying to get there and they finally get you there. You look here, you take the high tip. So, and there's some other information here. You can see the average tip per hour and also how the fare amount by weekday and, basically what kind of payment type they use, right, in most cases. So it's usually cash. Okay. So that's pretty much it for this visualization. But the next thing we had is obviously the most amount of data. Now keep in mind when we go through this visualization, right, this is now going against the full set of data. So it's, as you guys saw, it was 220 gigs of data that it's looking through. So every time I click a different visualization, if there's three visualizations, it has to scan the entire table. So I actually jump a little bit ahead because for this particular visualization, I actually really wanted to look under the hood and kind of show you guys the queries that it's running, okay? So that you basically find this more believable. So this is the table. This is our management tool, right, that we use to run queries. So you look at the table here, right, the trips table. You can see all the information here, the pickup date time, the passenger count, and et cetera. You can see the data types that are used to store the information, right? So you can see that it has the pickup date time and the drop-off date time, and that's a timestamp. So in order for us to get a year, we actually have to extract run a function every time on a timestamp to extract the year. So that means that we pretty much have to do a whole table scan to extract that information. So so I'm just gonna take, do an execute just to show you that. I'm sorry, what's the question? No, there's no keys. No, there's no keys. It's just literally raw data. There you go. Sorry about that. Okay, so you can see that I just ran select count just to show you what's in the table and came back with 1.3 billion rows. Okay, so let's take the next one. So this query is a fairly simple query and it tells you the number of trips made and the distance traveled by year by different groups of travelers, right? So if you look at the query, it's not complicated, it's not joining any tables, right? All it's doing is a straight select and some aggregation, right, run some functions and et cetera. So it does a year pickup date time, right? So it casts it and it provides you passenger totals and et cetera, right? And then the most complex thing here is the group by, right? So it has to sort the data. So I'm gonna execute this query and it goes out, it scans the entire table. This query will scan the entire table and it came back in 5.7 seconds, right? The whole 220 gigs of data were scanned and it returned the results. So let's go to the next one. So this one has a it basically displays the valid data, right, for passengers from 1 to 50 passengers that were using a taxi cab. It's basically trying to get the valid data. And it's not only for 2016, I actually made it wider. It's 2015 through 2017, and it's basically up to 5 miles. I just wanted to put some aggregates in there and also some where clauses to basically narrow down the data set. So I'm going to execute this query, and you can see this query came back almost instantaneously. came back in 0.4 seconds.
Okay. How could you get 9 people before?
I'm sorry?
How could you get 9 people?
That's a good question. I was looking at some of the data and I was like, 50 people, they must have recorded as one ride and then they get like a bus or something like that, or maybe several cabs and etc. I'm not entirely sure. There was some really interesting data in there. So the next one is, what is the passenger count for each day for every month of and every day of the month? Okay, so as you can see, this is also some aggregation ones. This also will do a full table scan, right, and then provide a sum of passenger counts. So it came back in 7.1 seconds. I can continue going, but I just kind of wanted to give you an idea, okay? So now let's go back to our 1.3 billion row table. And I'm gonna try to load the first. Okay, that was fast. Okay, so that loaded the queries, right? The same kind of markup, except this is providing information number for all years. So we have the year filter there, so we wanted to, we could filter it. But for now, we just went and it just got all the data and basically displaying the totals for all years that we have stored in the database. So the same thing for the next one. You can see it's very similar to the other demo. So when we load, it comes back and it gives you a number of total passengers and etc. So you can see here that it actually has 1.6 billion now tips, right? This is for all 8 years. And then the total fare of $18 billion for all 8 years that we have stored in the database. And then finally, we can go to tips to see how generous. I modified these graphs slightly. So this one actually, you can scroll down here, it's kind of a heat map, and it can tell you actually by weekday, so you can scroll out each weekday, you can see the amount of tips, maybe on Saturday or Sunday, the tips are more generous, right? So I can actually kind of scroll down here and kind of take a look at what the tips look like for Friday, this is Friday, and Saturday, and etc. And then finally at the end, this is something relevant for the year only, right? So I displayed the passenger counts for each year, basically for by year, 2009, 2010. And then here, I just wanted to kind of see how does by year, the total fare amount compares to the, let's say, tip amount, right? So the line you see here is the tips paid. How does it relate to the green bars, which are the fare paid, you know? So yeah, so as I said, these queries run directly. The whole point of this is to show you guys that you can use any visualization tool to view your data, okay? And it helps when the database runs quickly under the covers because you don't have to sit and wait for the dashboards to load all this information, okay? So I guess if you guys have any questions, we're here, so you're welcome to ask questions.
So the question was, how do we implement updates and deletes in Hadoop? So what happens is when you issue an update or a delete, we store it in what we call, you know, positional delta trees. These are memory overlays, so they live in memory. So when you run a query afterwards to scan this data, we know that there's some overlays in memory. We go to the memory, we go to disk, we do the join, so we don't, it doesn't affect performance. I don't have a slide here, I can email it to you later, when we did the performance again, Hive and Kala were 900 times faster. And after you updated the data, they got slower by around 50% slower, or we only got slower by 1 second, for example, because that's the time it takes to scan the data. And again, that's something we patented, and that's how we do updates and deletes. Yes?
When you said you looked at the column and you can do an index of minimum and maximum, supposing the column has a lot of missing data, is that indicative?
When you say missing data?
Well, for you use something for age. Let's say there are quite a few, there's no age.
If it's nulls, you mean, or
yeah,
something else? Yes, we flag that there could be nulls there, so we also flag that.
So the minimum and maximum, that flag as well, that is...
Yeah. So when you flag, you know, if you say it's age and it's null, we have a second min-max index to track the nulls. But the original index only tracks the minimum and maximum value in that specific block.
And going back to that, age would usually be a computed column.
Correct. Or, you know...
But
Well,
so I said 8 minus, you know. Yeah, that's fine. But again, we do those min-max indices on every panel, and that's how we're able to quickly discard data that does not fit the workflows for you. We do support indices, but you don't have to create them, because as you saw, everything is really fast. You don't need to create any indices.
Do you have access to
all?
Yes.
It is stored in the series. Yes. So we will have some more webcam coverage to give you. Let's see. Question, how many tweets are there on Twitter in a day? Just throw out numbers.
Too many.
656 million. There you go. I don't know, do we have any other? How many Instagram posts are uploaded each day?
700. I have a question. Do you guys know the difference between warm and cold queries? So in analytics, warm and cold queries are a big deal, right? So how many of you guys know the difference? Warm and cold queries.
One with cubes is warm.
Hmm?
The one with cubes is warm.
No. Okay. Yes.
Warm is cached.
Exactly. Warm queries are cached. Where are you, Nick? I remember you.
So before we take the two more questions, I just want to remind you guys, we are going to give away in a very few minutes. Come out as I intended. In a very short time, in a few minutes, this Echo Dot as well as this Amazon Cloud Cam. In order to win, you do have to have your business card in here, or you can write your business card on a piece of paper, like create a new one as long as it looks like a real business card, meaning contact info. If you pull a card out and the winner has only a name, you will not win. Does anyone need this to put their picture, put their info in?
Two more of these, one.
Okay, we are going to do the drawing right now.
Yes, I'm present to win.
You need to. Alright. First question is, who wants to win this?
Alright. So let's do.
Can I ask you to reach in and make sit all up?
I hope you can.
Okay. Can I ask you to look that way and reach in and pull out a card?
No.
Read it out.
Kenji Furuta.
Kenji Furuta?
Yeah.
Alright, congratulations. Be here for one-on-one questions. Feel free right now to come on up and ask them. And I want to thank our awesome speakers of the evening, and thank you all for coming.